What's the first step? If I need some volume of concrete, what is the first thing that I need to do? Anyone?
So figure out what grade of cement you need.
You're not audible.
Figuring out what grade of cement you need.
Okay, next. Once we figured out all the different materials that we want to use, what is the next thing that we need to do? What is the first thing you do when you do anything? Say, take cook again. I keep drawing this cooking analogy every time. If you have a recipe and you have to make a dish, what is the first thing that you do? Once you have procured all the materials, what do you do? Correct. You do measurement, Avinash. Right. We measure what amount of water is to be added to make mix. Okay, once you've measured the different quantities of everything, what do you do?
Prepare a mixture.
Mixing, correct. After you measure things, you mix things. Okay, once you've mixed concrete, what do you do? What do all these workers do once the concrete is mixed?
Testing.
Correct. So there are a few tests that needs to be done on fresh properties of concrete called workability tests. Okay. So this lump test and everything. So these tests technically do not come under manufacturing as a process. It is more of a quality control measure. Okay. Meaning before you use this concrete in construction activity, you need to ensure that the concrete is of right quality or right properties. So you do a few tests. Okay. These tests we learn in the next unit. Okay, once the testing is done and say we know that the quality of concrete is good, what do we do next? What do we do with concrete once it is mixed?
Apply on the required area.
Correct. So going and pouring it in required areas, we use a term called placing. Okay, placing of concrete, meaning once the mixing is done, we go and place it wherever we want, inside the formwork, inside the shuttering, okay, so that it can be poured there and can set and harden. Okay, so we'll try and finish that much today. Can you guys see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is the order of things. So first is your batching. Whatever you said, they said measuring, correct? So batching is an equivalent word for measuring, where we measure how much quantity of water is to be used, then mixing. Then you take this concrete from the place where it was mixed to the place where it is going to be poured and placed. Okay, that's called transporting. Next, you have placing. And then once it is placed, you need to remove the air voids that is there, okay, and ensure it is densified. So you do something called as compaction. Once it is compacted and set and hardened, we need to do something called as curing. Okay, the most common form of curing you guys would have probably seen is simply pouring water over concrete, or you know, ponding, where you put a layer of water over it and build mud bunds around it. Or maybe the other type you would have observed is you take gunny bags, okay, and cover the concrete surfaces and keep the gunny bag wet all the time. So, and then of course finishing, which is just to make sure that the surface finishing is smooth. So these are the various processes from start to finish. So let us start with batching. So when we talk about batching, I told you about bulking of sand. Remember the phenomenon where there is an apparent increase in the volume of sand due to the presence of moisture. So this bulking actually has a lot of detrimental effect if the batching is not done properly. So based on how we're measuring things, we can classify batching into two types. One is volume batching, the other is way batching. Okay, in volume batching, we measure the items based on volume. Okay, say one pan, two pans, one box, two box. So this is a volumetric method of measurement. And since it is volumetric, it is not a very accurate, way of measuring things. Okay, especially for aggregates when it is in wet condition. So this volume method that is used is mainly used for small projects, like individual houses, small projects where you can't really afford to buy a wave batching setup. Okay, and the degree of quality control that is desired is not too much. Meaning even if you're aiming for an M15, but to get an M20 or M25, you know, based on all these site mix measures, it is fine. They're not going to lose anything. So for small projects, volume batching is fine. Okay, and how do you measure these volumes? At least in the Indian scenario, we use those spans. Okay, we call them Makri down south. So you use those spans to measure, well, you know, one pan of sand, two pans of coarse aggregate, so on and so forth. And you use those. But in the general context, if volume batching can also be done scientifically to an extent using something called as a gauge box. So this is a gauge box. Okay. So in a lot of foreign countries where you can't really, you know, in remote areas where you can't do wave batching, volume batching is still adopted. So these are basically boxes whose volume is equal to volume of one bag of cement. Okay. So when we say all those ratios like 1:2:3, it is easier to maintain. So all I have to do is fill one bag of cement into this. So the cement part is taken care of. Then fill two boxes of fine aggregate, pour it out, three boxes of coarse aggregate, pour it out. Then pour water and mix. Okay. So these gauge boxes are easier to maintain, you know, those nominal ratios that we keep talking about. And these boxes are normally made of timber or some metal. Okay, and the reason they're deep and narrow is because the material should not, you know, fly off. Okay, and a large amount can be contained within it. So this is as far as volume batching is concerned. Okay, typically used for smaller projects, very unscientific. The mix that is obtained in the end might not be, you know, very accurate in terms of the strength that you plan to get. Okay. And especially when we are using aggregates that are in wet condition, you are using material less than what is required because then the volume is more than what it actually is. Okay, so volume batching is a bad idea. If you guys ever have an option between choosing volume batching and wave batching, always go with wave batching. All the experiments that we do in the lab will always measure things only by weight. Okay, maybe only thing you'll measure by volume is water, but then again that is not really a problem because your density of water is 1000. So your weight of water is equal to volume of water. So it won't really matter. Meaning you take 1 liter of water, it is equal to 1 kg of water. So it won't really matter. But whereas for other things, it doesn't matter. Okay. And one more thing is, if you're using all these gauge boxes and pans, when you transporting material or, you know, measuring material, you should never compact it. Meaning you simply pour the contents into the box. Don't tamp it and then, because when you're pre-compacting the materials. So in a way, you're adding more materials than is required. Okay, just keep that in mind. The next method is wave batching. It is more scientific, it is more accurate. The quality of concrete that you get at the end of wave batching is correct. Say, for example, take bulking only for example. Even if you add a slight amount of water into the sand, even if the volume increases, doesn't matter. The weight is going to be the same. Okay, so always adopt wave batching. So under wave batching, we can classify them into three types based on how you're measuring: manual, semi-automatic, and fully automatic. In manual, obviously human intervention is required. You manually take out these materials, put it on a weighing machine, measure how much is there, and go pour it into the mixer for the mixing to happen. In semi-automatic, what happens? There are these shuttering gates, okay, or these shutters that are there that open at regular intervals to allow certain amount of materials to flow through. So it is semi-automatic in the sense the discharge of materials that is happening automatically. But the weighing and dumping into the mixer, you might have to do by yourself. In a fully automatic thing, what happens? Everything is automized. So all you have to do is press a button. So right from taking of the material using conveyor belts from the dumping yard to placing it on the weighing machine to dumping it into the mixer before mixing is fully automatic. So most of the ready-mix concrete plants that have, you know, been set up in the last 3-4 years, employ this fully automatic method, because the minute humans get involved, there is a tendency for, you know, errors to accumulate, because we are not very efficient, at least not very efficient as would be a wrong thing to say. We are not as efficient as machines, because machines are more or less foolproof. So you program it to do a certain task, you make sure it has the electricity and the materials that is available, it will do its job effectively. Okay, so fully automatic. The human is required only to, you know, push the on and off button and nothing else. So once the batching is done, either by, you know, way batching or volume batching, it is to be mixed. Okay, so this mixing can again be done, you know, by various ways, depending on the size of the project, depending on how much budget you have. Okay, and depending on also, I think, how easy you want to make a construction. So obviously, if you have like a 20 story building, you can't go on hand mixing concrete for a 20 story building. One, it will take time. Two, it is, I don't know, uneconomical. You'll need a lot of laborers. And the quality of concrete that you get at the end of hand mixing is not really going to be good. So if you have a high story building where, you know, quality is a primary concern, strength is a primary concern, you shouldn't mind spending some extra money and ordering concrete from a ready mix concrete plant. Okay. So here are the three methods that is mentioned, say hand mixing, stationary mixers, and ready mix concrete is in the order of quality control. So hand mixers, obviously the worst quality, stationary mixers slightly better than hand mixing, but still not as good as ready mix concrete. And ready mix concrete is the best, at least currently commercially available options. RMC is the best. Okay. And this mixing time is sometimes also called as gauging time. So you should not over mix the concrete as well, and you should not under mix it as well. How do you know that you've mixed the concrete effectively? So your entire mass at the end of mixing should look like one uniform thing. There should be no lumps, the color, there should be no discoloring. The entire thing should be one solid color, which is gray. And no part should be, you know, one part shouldn't be dry, one part shouldn't be wet. The entire volume of concrete should be of uniform consistency when you're, you know, pouring it. So let us start with the first method of mixing by hands. I think the method on the left is something that all of us would have observed. You make a huge heap of all the dry materials and then create a, you know, depression like a volcano sort of a thing. Pour water in between and start dry folding materials inside. Okay. So all the dry materials that is on the outskirts, once you start bringing it inside, so it is a cycle. So one way, you are not letting that water flow out of that depression that you created. Okay, and this hand mixing is normally done using, you know, trowels and shovels. So like I said, not very accurate because you don't know if the mix has been efficient or not. Okay, the method on the right is still hand mixing because although you're using a mixer, that is not a mechanically or an electrically operated mixer. So at the end of on the other side of that mixer, you have a wheel sort of a thing, like those wheels that you have on a ship, like something like a steering wheel. So you might pour the materials inside the mixer there. The mixing is still happening because you're rotating the drum with your hand. Okay, you're rotating and rotating, and that is why the mixing is being done. So if you look at these two, obviously the image on the right is slightly better than the image on the left because in terms of consistency, the end product might be slightly better than hand mixing that is happening on the right. But still, since it is human energy that is required to run the machine, it might not really be effective. If the labor on that day, on that particular day, is tired and it does not do the required number of revolutions, your end product might not actually be good. So that is as far as hand mixing is concerned. Again, to be done only for smaller volumes, okay, for smaller projects, it is highly uneconomical and not advisable for larger projects. Next. Talking about stationary mixers, when we say stationary, it means it is standing in a place. And I say standing in a place, it does not necessarily mean it does not have wheels, but it does not have like an engine or a, you know, driving compartment where you can drive it. You can probably attach it to another vehicle and drag it along like a bogey, but it does not have steering set up by itself. So in stationary mixes, you have two types. Okay, one is tilting type and the other is non-tilting type. I think most of y'all would have seen this. Okay, this is a tilting type. So what happens in a tilting type is you have a drum mixer. You have a drum, a cylindrical drum with a conical opening on top. So from the opening top end, first we make this vertical, okay, or more or less vertical, pour all the materials inside. And once the mixing is done, we use this wheel to rotate it downwards, and the concrete comes out of the same hole through which you poured the initial materials. So there's only one opening here. Okay, so you pour the materials in a vertically upward position, mix it, pour it down, the concrete comes out through the same hole that is there on the top. So this is a what? Tilting type drum mixer. So then next you have something called as a non-tilting type. So in non-tilting type, what happens? You have you still have a cylindrical drum, but here the rotation happens about this axis. Okay, but here the rotation happens along the horizontal axis. So this is a cylinder that keeps turning round and round like this. So in this, what happens? There are two openings. One opening is on the side, okay, through which you feed the material. So I add material into this. From here, it goes into the drum and it falls into this. So the opening is provided at the bottom. Okay, so there is a shutter gate sort of a thing that is there. You open that, the material will fall below. So this is a non-tilting type. So why is it non-tilting? Because in the previous case, to remove the material out of, you know, the drum mixer, you had to tilt the drum. In this case, you don't have to. You open the gate at the bottom and the concrete will simply fall out. So it is non-tilting. Okay, what are the two key things here? We have to differentiate here. In tilting type, one opening, same opening is used for loading materials and removing concrete. And the removal of concrete is achieved by tilting the drum mixer at a lower angle so that concrete can be poured out. Here, there is two openings, one to load the materials, which is on the side face of the drum. One to remove the material, which is at the bottom. Okay, and the removal of concrete is happening by opening a chute that is available at the bottom. So that is as far as stationary mixers is concerned. So like I said, you still have wheels. So when I say stationary, it doesn't mean it is fixed to one place. You can still drag it along, but you can't really, you know, sit on it and drive it. Okay, so the next type is obviously what? An improvement over this, where there's a driver compartment, it has its own engine, it has its own wheels, and you can drive it to wherever you want. These mixers are called transit mixers. Okay, so what happens in transit mixers is, so you have ready-mix concrete plants. You would have probably seen plants like this, where it is a central processing unit sort of a place, where you have all the materials. So all these materials are, the batching, weighing, everything, etc. is done in the RMC plant. And once the dry mix is obtained, this dry mix is poured into the truck. Okay. So again, you have two types here. So if you mix water with the dry mix in the central plant itself and pour the wet concrete into the truck, okay, and send the truck to deliver that wet concrete, it is called central mixed. Central mixed meaning the concrete is manufactured literally in the plant using the, this truck, the transit truck, simply to deliver this wet concrete from RMC plant to the site. So it is a central mixed concrete. And then you have something called as a truck mixed. In truck mixed, what happens? You only do a dry mix. You only measure how much cement is required, fine aggregate is required, coarse aggregate is required. You dump all the dry materials into the truck, but do not add water in the factory itself. You add water wherever you want after you reach the site or maybe on the way to the site. I'll tell you the advantages and disadvantages of both. So what happens in central mixed is, say I need concrete, you know, to be delivered to some place in Kengeri, and my RMC plant is in Kumbalgud. Okay, the distance between these two places is hardly 10 to 15 kilometers, and it would probably take maximum of 1 hour even under the worst traffic conditions. So it is normally advisable to, you know, use concrete within the first two to two and a half hours of mixing of concrete. So this 1 hour is still fine. So since this, transit duration is only 1 hour, I can go ahead and do this central mixed concrete. So I can ask the RMC guy to mix the concrete in the plant itself and pour it into the transit truck and send it. Okay. Whereas think of someplace else. Say the delivery site is in JP Nagar and the RMC plant is still in Kumbalgud. So if he has to take it all the way from Kumbalgud all the way to JP Nagar, it would easily take 3 hours under, you know, peak traffic, sometimes even more, especially the Nayan Delhi junction in the evenings when there's a traffic jam, it could probably take more. So in such cases, what happens if you, centrally mix concrete and then send it, the 2.5 hours would elapse on the way. By the time the concrete reaches the site, it would be too late. Okay. So to avoid this problem, to not waste concrete, what we do, we only dry mix materials, pour it into the drum mixer. And these days, the transit mixers that you can see also come equipped with a water tank. Okay, if you can see here, this image, there is a water tank here. So somewhere on the way, okay, a few hours, one and a half hours before the truck reaches the site where it is to be delivered, the driver simply has to, you know, enable this water from the water tank to go into the drum, and the mixing can start happening. Or the mixing can even happen once the truck has reached the site. Okay, sometimes what happens, there's, you know, these unforeseen rains that happen. Okay, and you can't really do concreting when it's raining, because it doesn't make any sense, it'll get washed out. So in such cases, what happens, the trucks can be present at the site. Okay, and once the rain is stopped, you can pour water into the drum mixer, the mixing can happen, and then you can place it. So if given an option between a central mixed and the truck mixed, maybe central mixed concrete is going to be more uniform, in the sense the quality of mixers that is there in the RMC plant itself might be better. Okay, but in terms of handling unforeseen situations and not to ensure concrete is not wasted, using these truck mixed concrete is better. Okay, so under central mixed, again, once the concrete is prepared and mixed, you can deliver it to site in two types of trucks. So these two types of trucks are called agitating trucks and non-agitating trucks. Agitating trucks are basically trucks where you keep turning and rotating the concrete mix so that it does not set and harden. A non-agitating truck is like, I don't know, your Tempo. Very simply pour concrete and take it from one point to another. So agitated truck is preferable where, there is a transit distance of about, 1 and a half hours. Non-agitating trucks, say within 10 to 15 minutes. If it's more than that, non-agitating is bad because your concrete will start to set. Okay, so this is an example for an agitator truck. This is a rotating blade. It will keep rotating the concrete or, keep moving it around till it is delivered to the site. This is another type of agitator truck. There is a huge drum inside. There is actually a Newton wheel. So it lifts and drops the concrete over a period. So it you are basically mixing it throughout the transit. Okay, and this is a non-agitating truck. It is simply a truck. So this can only be used if the distance between the mixing site and the delivery site is very close. Otherwise, it'll set. And if you try to remove concrete from the truck after it is set, it is a lot of headache. Okay, so agitating, non-agitating trucks that is used to deliver concrete from the central mix site to the place where you are using, where the concrete is needed. So these things will again sort of come into picture when you're talking about transporting of concrete. So keep in mind, because you are mixing and transporting, processes that is happening simultaneously. Okay. And then, like I said, you have truck mix concrete. You pour the dry materials there and then add the water, into the drum on the way, and then mix it and then deliver it. Okay. So this is as far as mixing of concrete is concerned. So next, once the mixing is done, you need to transport this concrete from wherever it is mixed to wherever it is needed. And some of these examples we've already studied in the form of these trucks. Okay. But what are the other measures? So in all these small projects, you would have seen all these laborers and masons, etc., would stand in one long line. Okay. And they'd pass these pans from one person to another. Sometimes even between stories, they throw it from one story to another. They catch, and then pour it. So that is the easiest method. So you have these mortar pans that is there. You fill concrete into it, transfer it manually, and then pour it, send the empty tray back to be filled again. So easiest way, it is very labor intensive, not economical. And since there's a lot of mechanical energy involved, during the process of transportation, it might get compacted, and there might be a degree of water loss that exists. Okay, so the next slightly better method, as an evolution over using pans, is using wheelbarrows or these buggies that you can see. So wheelbarrows, the volume of concrete that you can handle is slightly better, obviously. So you pour concrete into this and take it from one point to another and then pour it out. But again, there are a few disadvantages with this. You can use it only if the pouring is at one level, meaning if you mix concrete in the ground floor, there is no way you can push it up to first floor and then pour it there, unless you have built like something like a ramp or something. So better than pan but not cannot be used in all the places where a pan can be used. A pan you can move from one story to another, you know, by throwing it. This you can't because it's going to be heavy. So this is a wheelbarrow. The next thing would be a belt conveyor. So you know what conveyor belts are, right? So it basically is a rotating, think of it like an escalator, but it is made of belt and it is moving things from one point to another instead of moving people. So this is a typical example for a belt conveyor. So here that problem of transferring from one story to another does not exist. So you mix concrete in one point, you pour it into the belt conveyor, it will go and dump it at the other end. This again has slight limitations. Limitations in the sense that angle of inclination of a belt conveyor cannot exceed a certain degree of inclination. Beyond a certain degree, if you start inclining it, the material will start flowing downwards. It does not get transferred from a lower level to a higher level. Okay, so belt conveyors better and preferably, it can be used for places where both mixing and placing is happening at the same level, or from a higher level to lower level is fine. From a lower level to higher level with slight degrees of inclination is fine. If the angle of inclination is more, it will not work. So like the more we move above and above, the more effective the method of delivery gets, correct? So the next method, it is something that can be used everywhere, especially for high rises. So you use cranes and buckets. So you mix the concrete at ground level. You use cranes to lift these buckets that contain concrete. And there's a shutter at the bottom of this bucket here. Okay. So you open those gates or shutters or whatever, and the concrete is poured. The only problem here is there's a lot of time that is wasted in using this crane to lift the material from up and from bottom to up, and then opening the gate, sending it down again. And in case of windy areas, it can be a risky affair. Okay, because this behaves like a single degree of freedom pendulum and it starts vibrating, and you obviously have traffic, population, etc. that is moving below. Okay, and you don't really want to dump material on them, or if that thing the wire or snaps and breaks, it can be a lot of damage. So the next and the most advanced method of placing concrete is using pumps. So you mix concrete at site, you place it into this pump, and the concrete is pumped. Okay, so locally and also I think in the industry, these pumps is called as boom placer. Okay, or placer or boom placer, whatever. So this again has its limitations, meaning if the concrete is very harsh, if it is not very runny, it might get clogged. Okay, so concrete with huge aggregates, concrete that have harsh mixes, cannot really be pumped to greater distances. So, and there is also a limitation in terms of the number of stories it can be pumped to at once. Okay, so sometimes what happens, you'll have to do a multi-level pump. You send it from first floor to 10th floor. From 10th floor, you pump it again to the next 10 floors. So it becomes difficult. But again, compared to all the other methods, this is the only method that can sort of be employed for high-rise buildings. So the most advanced method, using boom placers, which employ pumps. Okay, you might get all these images as questions in quiz. Identify the method of transporting of and placing of concrete that is adopted here. Next, the transporting, and the last thing, we've already discussed this. So this is over large distances. When the mixing site and the delivery place is slightly far away, you pour it into this and then deliver it. But this is not an end-to-end transporting thing like the previous cases. So once the delivery truck brings it to the site, you still need some means of mechanism to remove the concrete out of this truck and then place it. So you'll still have to use one of these methods in addition to using the truck to transport concrete to wherever it is to be placed. Okay. Next, how much time do we have? We'll finish compaction also then. So once the concrete is transported and it is placed inside the formwork, like I said, you need to do something called as compaction. So like I told you, air is something that is present everywhere simply by virtue of its presence. And you cannot really remove it, not at least 100%, unless you use a huge suction device to create a vacuum or whatever. But you can't obviously, you know, build all such things to effectively compact concrete. So there is a study that says for every 1% of air that is entrained in concrete, the strength of concrete reduces by 6%. Okay. So when we did a gel space ratio problem also, I told you, you would get theoretical strength such as 120 MPa, 90 MPa and all that. But in reality, you know, getting a 60 MPa these days is a huge achievement. Why is that, you know, a problem is, theoretically 100% hydration, etc. is fine. Sometimes even if 100% hydration has happened, you might have a lot of air pockets inside. And these air pockets obviously are a weak zone. So when you apply, you know, load onto concrete, the cracks start at these tiny air pockets that are there, and they start propagating through the interfacial transition zone that is present. Okay, so air voids is something that cannot be completely eliminated, but compaction is a process that we try and do to remove as much as these voids and air as possible. Okay. So this is done effectively to remove air and to ensure greater density and more strength. Okay. So what are the different ways of compacting? Again, we'll go from the least effective method to the most effective method. So the least effective method is obviously doing it manually. So, okay, we'll classify them like this. Manually, we can do it by three things. One, by using a rod. The other by using a rammer, the other by using a tamper. And these processes are called rodding, ramming and tamping. Next, the most effective, I think more effective and more economical and more widely accepted methods of compacting is by using a mechanical device. Okay, it is called a vibrator or a compactor or a compaction device. So here again, you have different types. I'll explain them with the help of a figure at a later point. So first, let us deal with manual compaction. So this is called as the rodding, and the, you know, the rod that he is holding in his hand is called a tamping rod. So in our lab, when we're doing you know, slump test or casting cubes, we will be using a tamping rod itself. So this tamping rod is typically of 16 mm diameter and 60 centimeter length. Okay, the minimum length should be 20 centimeter, because otherwise it cannot effectively compact it. But the Indian standard tamping rod size is 16 mm diameter and 60 centimeter length. So two scale length, remember. So what happens in rodding is, you fill the concrete in, you know, multiple layers, use this rod to penetrate it, and then just keep rodding it so that the voids that is present there is eliminated. Okay, the one of the least effective methods of compaction is rodding, because one, the compactive effort that you're applying is less, because the rod, you know, has a round edge and you're not applying it over a huge area to remove the voids. You're only, you know, doing it in bits and pieces. So rodding can be effective for things that have, you know, a lesser cross-section area, like a small pipe or small cylinder where you can't really do heavy compaction. You put a rod and then compact it. So the next type is by using a ramming, So the thing that you see on top is a rammer, okay? So there is a difference between a rammer and a tamper, in the sense, this is used for, you know, smaller applications, okay? And a rammer is typically done for PCC. So what is PCC? I told you what RCC is, you know, you remember reinforced cement concrete. So PCC is when I'm using only concrete without any reinforcement. So that is called plain cement concrete. So we use it for things like, you know, just filling areas such as pavements and leveling surfaces where there's no reinforcement inside. So in such cases, use rammer, where the depth of the concrete that is poured is less. And you can use that, you know, metallic plate with a wooden handle to tamp it. If the depth of the concrete is more, ramming it will not help. So, and coming next, a tamper works like a rammer, but it is slightly bigger in size. Okay. And it can be used for RCC applications, where the, you know, thickness of concrete layer that you've poured is slightly more than whatever you do for ramming. And if you notice, the bottom plate that is there, the head of the tamper, is also bigger than the rammer. Okay. And this is typically made of wood, which has a very flat surface. And the other probable difference could be after ramming is done, you can't expect the surface to be super smooth. Okay, ramming is simply done to compact it, not to finish the surface. Whereas in tamping, it sort of works as a both compaction device and a finishing device. So you use the tamper to not only compact and remove the air voids, but also ensure that the surface is, you know, flat and finished at the end of it. Next, now the mechanical methods by using vibrator. Okay, so here you have different types again based on the need, necessity, application, and what you're building, how you're building, where you're building. So the easiest thing is using something called as a needle vibrator. We have a few of these in our labs actually. So what we do in a needle vibrator is you have a long needle that is attached to a motor, which sort of induces vibration into the needle. So you place this needle into wherever you have poured concrete. Okay, so that this vibration that is transferred from the needle to the concrete removes the air voids. Okay, so this can be done in remote areas where you can't, you know, you carry heavy machinery, or you don't really have these Formburg vibrators. So this can also be used for a lot of applications. The only place where it cannot be used is probably if the pour of concrete is too deep. Think of something like a dam. Okay, the length of this is going to be very small. So maybe in such places you can't use it. And one more thing you need to keep in mind is this diameter of the needle vibrator that is there should be, you know, 1/3 of the Formburg size that you're using. Meaning if you're making a beam that is 200 mm wide, okay, you can't have a needle that is 200 mm wide because it will disrupt. So 1/3 of 200 is how much? 66 point something. So you need to use a needle vibrator that is around 70 mm diameter. Anything more than that, it will disrupt the Formburg and it would cause a lot of problems. Okay, commercially, I think you only have about two sizes. You have 40 mm and these days you have 60 mm. So these sizes are fine. And using needle vibrator, what happens? If you over compact it, okay, meaning if you place it in one place for a very long time, it is actually damage. It will damage concrete in ways you can't think about. So it will force the concrete, it will force the water to separate from the rest of the cement paste, and the water will rise to the surface. Okay, so that is why we always tell compaction is something that should be done, you know, in a controlled manner. You under compact it, voids are present, the strength of concrete reduces. You over compact it, you know, there's a huge amount of water loss. The water comes to the surface, there's segregation, there is bleeding, and there is lesser strength again. So it always has to be done to the right amount to ensure effective removal of voids is there. At the same time, no segregation or bleeding is happening. Okay. The next type of vibrator is something called as an external vibrator. So this is an image. So we use these things for, you know, things like constructing the metro girders, where you have a huge formwork. We've already poured concrete inside, but you can't, you know, insert the needle vibrator because the entire thing is too deep. So what we do, we take these external vibrators or formwork vibrators, mount it on the formwork, on the shuttering, and switch it on. Okay. Sometimes this is held by the use of magnetic, you know, electromagnetic power, and sometimes it is due to suction cups that is present on the other side. Okay. You place it there, switch it on. Once you feel like enough compaction is done, you can simply remove it from the formwork and take it to wherever else, you know, it needs to be used. One advantage with this method is there is no cleaning involved. So in the previous case, you have to pour it into concrete. So the next time before you use it, you'll obviously have to clean it. So there's a lot of wear and tear that happens. Here, the vibrator is never really coming in touch with concrete at all. The concrete is inside the formwork, and this you're placing it on the external. Okay, so in terms of maintaining it or cleaning it, this is quite easy. Okay, this again has some limitation in the sense, if it is a huge thing and you have to simultaneously compact the entire thing from all directions, you will need multiple external vibrators. You can't, you know, keep shifting the same thing everywhere. It will cause segregation and bleeding again. So when compaction happens, it has to happen throughout the structure simultaneously. If you do, you know, one pocket of concrete once and then the others, So there will be differential compaction. And when you're compacting one area, there's a possibility that water from that area would escape to the other area. And when you do the other area and come back here, the homogeneity is not maintained. Okay. Next is something called as a table vibrator. So both table vibrator and platform vibrator is something that is limited to laboratory applications. You can't really put an entire building or an entire, you know, beam column setup on top of your table or a platform vibrator. It can be used for other applications. Say, for example, when you have to make concrete blocks or paver blocks, these blocks that you use for pavements, correct? These footpaths, such places you can use table and platform vibrator. You might have all these molds into which the concrete is poured. These molds, you can come and place it on top of these table vibrator. This table vibrator is mounted on springs. Okay, in both the cases, you can see both table and platform. The difference between table and platform is simply the size and the carrying capacity. A table will be capable of carrying less load. A platform is slightly more load. But the application is still. So it is mounted on a spring. So the entire top can move. And at the bottom of the... mass is rotating, it causes vibration. So if you've ever noticed, if you put very few clothes in a washing machine, correct? So when a washing machine is running at full load, it might not vibrate too much or cause a lot of noise. But if you put only one or two heavy clothes in a washing machine and, you know, put it on wash, what happens is there's this loaded eccentric mass that is rotating. Whenever there's an eccentric mass unevenly distributed about the center of the axis of rotation, it causes vibration. So we use that logic to, you know, move the top of the tables here. So now can be used only for what? Manufacturing small scale concrete products, cannot be used as applications for buildings as such. So limited to blocks, paver blocks, small things. Okay. The last thing is a surface vibrator. This again can be used for things with small, lesser thickness. Okay. For things like slabs, things like pavements, where the depth is not more than 15 to, you know, 20 centimeter. So this is a tamper. So the way this works is, this still has, you know, that unbalanced mass concept. So you have one plate and there is another plate connected to springs on top. And you have these two handles. Once you move these handles, these two masses that is, you know, balanced in the spring sort of apply compactive energy on whatever surface you've placed it. Okay, so you can probably use it for all these pavement sort of a things, pathways, small things. I think that is all. Okay, I think we'll stop with that. We'll start with curing in the next class. Clear? Any doubts so far? So what are all the things we studied today? We did batching. Okay, how to measure the amount of materials that is required. Okay, under batching you have wave batching, volume batching, and under wave batching you have three types again. What are the three types? You have manual, semi-automatic, automatic. Okay, and then once the batching is done, you do mixing. Mixing can again be done with three ways: one by using hand, the other using stationary mixers, and then using the ready mix concrete. So hand mixing, either using shovels and trowels or a drum mixer without motor support. Stationary mixers, tilting type. Tilting type has one opening. Same opening is used for loading materials and removing concrete. Non-tilting type, two openings. One for loading materials, the other for removing concrete. Ready mix concrete, everything happens centrally. So depending on if water is mixed centrally or not, it can be classified as central mixed or truck mixed. Okay, once the concrete is mixed in the central RMC, it can be transported to the site using two types of trucks, agitating trucks and non-agitating trucks. And once the concrete is mixed to place, you can either use a pan or a wheelbarrow and a buggy or conveyor, cranes and buckets or your boom placers. Next, compaction of concrete can be done using by hand using rodding, ramming or tamping, and using all those mechanical devices that we spoke about. Clear? Any doubts? I think it is fairly simple. Okay. Just take care of the... Did someone say something? just take care of the nomenclature. Okay, whatever terms we've used to describe or call things, when you're writing answers in the test, use the same thing. Don't use a synonym or an equivalent word that means the same thing.